Support for the Legislative Gazette comes from New York State United Teachers, a union of professionals standing with more than 600,000 workers in education, human services, and healthcare with the Our Voice, Our Values, Our Union campaign. And United University Professions, representing 37,000 academic and professional employees at SUNY campuses and teaching hospitals across New York State. Frederick E. Cole, President. UUPinfo.org.
One day after State Attorney General Tish James called for a law to provide $50 million to New York abortion clinics to serve out-of-state patients, Governor Kathy Hochul says she can immediately free up $35 million for the clinics. The Legislative Gazette's Karen DeWitt explains.
Hochul announced the new funding in reaction to the leaked U.S. Supreme Court opinion that seeks to overturn the 1973 landmark abortion rights decision Roe v. Wade. The governor says the funds will subsidize travel, lodging, and other expenses associated with the procedure to be used for people who live in states where abortion would be banned if the Supreme Court does strike down Roe.
I'm directing the Department of Health to create New York's first fund ever to support abortion providers. $25 million will expand capacity and access for patients seeking abortion care, largest fund of its kind in our nation.
Hochul spoke via Zoom after testing positive for COVID-19 earlier this week, although she is asymptomatic. The governor says $10 million will also be available to increase security protections for clinics. The funding comes from the Health Department's Emergency Fund. It's controlled by the state's health commissioner, Dr. Mary Bassett. The money would be ready for distribution as soon as the court acts, Hochul says.
Being proactive. I said I'm better at playing offense than defense in anything I do. So we're preparing for this. It's going to take a little bit of time for the criteria to get out there, the information for the applications to come in online. So we're anticipating to have this go live as soon as that Supreme Court decision comes down.
The governor was joined virtually by leaders of Planned Parenthoods across the state and lawmakers, including Senate Finance Committee Chair Liz Krueger. Krueger also supports the law introduced Monday by Attorney General James that would provide $50 million in funding. Krueger predicts that even more money will be needed.
And I'm sorry, Governor, it's probably a down payment on other monies we're going to need to help to come up with to make sure that the people coming across state lines who will disproportionately be low income, young, and young women of color are able to come here and get the services they need.
While the state Democratic leaders support the funding, some Republicans do not. GOP Chair Nick Langworthy, in a statement, called Hochul's and the other Democrats' announcement manufactured hysteria designed to distract from the absolute dumpster fire they've created in New York. Langworthy says the governor and other New York Democrats should be focusing instead on the rising crime rate and high cost of living. In Albany, I'm Karen DeWitt.
You are listening to the Legislative Gazette, a program about New York State government and politics. I'm David Gostina. Joining us now, Legislative Gazette political observer Alan Chartock. Alan.
Joining us now, Legislative Gazette political observer Alan Chartock. Alan, race to fill Delgado's seat becomes key bellwether. State reporter Joel Mahoney has written an analysis of the Hudson Valley seat, the 19th district seat, purple district in New York that Antonio Delgado has filled until accepting the nomination for lieutenant governor from Kathy Hochul. He will vacate that seat. And it's looking, if you take his leaving Congress to be lieutenant governor, that could be up for grabs for the Republican.
Without any doubt, Molinaro is a popular figure. I think Delgado knew it, and I think Delgado knew that this might have been a time for a move now. When I say I think it, I don't have any proof. But when politicians make moves, you often say, What is their self-interest in all of this? Delgado is popular. He's done well. But there's always the possibility he could lose in an election against the popular Republican. And as we watch Delgado's moves, you have to consider what his potential political motivations were and are. Of course, we now know that if you're lieutenant governor of New York, you have a very good chance, or you have a chance, of becoming the governor. And that becomes an attractive place to be for Delgado. My sense of it is that if I were sitting in that spot and I was offered the lieutenant governorship and I had seen the present lieutenant governor, the present governor, move up from being lieutenant governor, I'd say, hey, this is worth a shot.
Well, here's a straightforward question, Alan. How is New York U.S. Senator, Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer doing?
Well, you know, it depends where you're sitting. If you're sitting in the Democratic caucus, which is, after all, what elects him as the chief Democrat in the Senate, and he's doing well for you and for your states, and he's being cautious and he listens to you, you might like him an awful lot. If you're some New Yorkers, particularly on the left-wing side, you might be saying, oh, we could be doing more. He should be pushing harder. He should be fighting harder. Hey, I wouldn't want that job, I can tell you right now. But I think he's acquitted himself, and I think he deserves credit for it.
Well, Alan, have the Democrats really screwed up this redistricting situation? Obviously, most seem to think it was the usual gerrymandering that goes on. We've seen it in other states, of course. Now we have competing election dates.
Well, there are election dates being scheduled all over the place in the spring, in the fall. Who knows what we're going to do? But, of course, it's been screwed up. Now, what was interesting to me is that our highest court, the Court of Appeals in New York State, comes along and they say you can't gerrymander in the state the way that you're planning to do. And they throw out the plan that the Democrats had come up with, where they would virtually eliminate most of the Republican congressional seats. Now, the Democrats are sitting up there. They have lofty ideals in the Court of Appeals. They're all appointed by Democrats, and yet they say this ain't right. Well, that's fine, but it's right in so many other states where they do gerrymander and they do make sure that only Republicans are going to win in some districts. So how do you say in New York, we're going to be a state of principle, but we're going to let the others run all over us?
Legislative Gazette political observer Alan Chartock. You are listening to the Legislative Gazette, a program about New York State government and politics. I'm David Giustina. Two New York State Senate candidates who battled it out for the 46th district seat in 2020 are now competing to represent the region being redrawn as the 48th district. The Legislative Gazette's Dave Lucas reports.
2 years ago, after initially finishing more than 8,200 votes behind Republican Richard Amador on election night, Democrat Michelle Hinchey declared victory in the race for an open seat in New York's 46th State Senate District. Absentee ballots eventually propelled Hinchey to a 3,000-vote victory. Amador, a retired state trooper who lives in Rensselaerville, says he's ready for a rematch.
This time, with the no-excuse absentee ballots getting voted down during the propositions on the last ballot cycle, there's going to be the regular absentee ballot rules, so we should be back down to 3,000 to 5,000 absentee ballots as in a normal year. And I know the district's been gerrymandered a little bit to give her a little bit more favorable seating, but I still think that we need to take government and get some leadership in there and try to fix some of the problems we have now.
The state Senate districts are being redrawn by a court-appointed expert after the map approved by the state legislature was deemed unconstitutional. Amador, who served 31 years with the New York State Police, says the district in 2022 faces supply chain issues, high gasoline prices, inflation, and could use a tweak of bail reform.
We need to get our economy opened again. We need to get we need to get things moving so we can get back to a normal way of life. Bail and discovery reform obviously is still a huge issue. I mean, the government's job is to keep you safe, and I think last time we were telling people what were going to happen with the bail and discovery reform. Now we have 2 years of data, and it's just everything we said is going to happen has happened. I mean, people are less safe because of bail and discovery reform. And the New York City Democrats will not even let anybody discuss it. Even Eric Adams, who's a police officer, realizes that it's killing New York City, bail and discovery reform. You know, people are just running around, can't put anybody in jail. And they sent him home with his tail between his legs. They won't even let him discuss modifications of it.
Amador, a former U.S. Army Reserve drill sergeant, promises constituents true leadership if elected.
Everything in my life has been about leadership and leading from the front and trying to solve problems. I've been solving problems for the people of this district for the last 35 years, and I know, given this position, I could do some good. We could move the case forward here, and instead of spinning our wheels and losing our youth, we could actually give some incentives to stay in the state of New York.
The 46th district has been redrawn as New York's 48th, which includes Greene County and the western half of Columbia County. Amador is not facing a primary challenger, nor is Hinchy. In that regard, the Hinchy campaign declined an interview with WAMC at this time. Hinchy decided against running for Congress this year after Democratic Representative Antonio Delgado of the 19th District was tapped to be New York's next lieutenant governor. Hinchy's late father, Maurice, represented the Hudson Valley in Congress for two decades. Election day is November 8.
For the Legislative Gazette, I'm Dave Lucas.
The North Country and Quebec Federation of Chambers of Commerce held a joint virtual webinar this week to hear from the U.S. ambassador to Canada. The Legislative Gazette's Pat Bradley was there and filed this report.
The Chambers webinar, titled Towards a New Era in Canada-U.S. Relations, welcomed David Cohen as the speaker. He was appointed by President Joe Biden to serve as U.S. ambassador to Canada and received unanimous confirmation by the Senate in November 2021. He previously was a senior advisor to the CEO of Comcast. North Country Chamber President Gary Douglas met Ambassador Cohen in person in Montreal in April and said he is looking forward to the new ambassador's approach to the binational relationship.
I have very quickly come to have great respect for the command that Ambassador Cohen is bringing to his position, and particularly the approach and culture that he's bringing to his position. He's clearly not just in his position to represent, but to facilitate, encourage, and to broaden and deepen the U.S.-Canadian relationship, which is what we're about, and we look forward to working with him to do exactly that.
Ambassador Cohen calls his appointment the honor of a lifetime.
I often say our partnership is unlike any other in the world. It's not just about trade or tourism, although both of those are important. It's about friendships and families that bridge the border. And our relationship is not just between governments in Ottawa and Washington, or even Quebec City and Albany. It's between communities and neighbors. And these more personal ties have enabled us to maintain a strong relationship, even in tough times.
Cohen discussed concepts outlined in the Roadmap for a Renewed U.S.-Canada Partnership, released following President Biden's first bilateral meeting with Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau in February 2021.
It's not just about prosperity or security or shared values. And it's not just strategy. There are a large number of very tactical elements to the roadmap. The roadmap is organized around six pillars: combating COVID-19, building back better from the pandemic, very importantly, in an equitable fashion, accelerating our climate ambitions, advancing diversity and inclusion, bolstering security and defense, and finally, building global alliances.
Written questions submitted via Zoom ranged from a softwood lumber trade dispute to the Buy American Act. One fielded by the chamber leaders asked Ambassador Cohen which industry sectors he believes will most strengthen binational cooperation.
We've talked about transportation and aerospace. We've also talked about clean electricity production and critical minerals. And I think those are the four biggest opportunities between Quebec and the United States. I think the most untapped of the group is critical minerals.
The seminar is part of a series of programs the North Country and Quebec Chambers have presented on cross-border issues.
For the Legislative Gazette, I'm Pat Bradley.
You are listening to the Legislative Gazette, a program about New York State government and politics. I'm David Gostina. Orange County Executive Stephen Neuhaus has returned to the U.S. after being deployed since mid-March with the Navy in Europe. Neuhaus, who is a lieutenant commander with the Navy Reserve, served with the 6th Fleet in response to the war in Ukraine. He spoke with the Legislative Gazette's Jim Lavoulis.
You know, it's interesting. I thought when I was first picked for this task that I would be going to do humanitarian work. And when I got there, it completely changed. And we were really on a force protection stance. Basically, the chairman of Joint Chiefs of Staff said, we are there, the 100,000 American troops is there to protect Europe's eastern flank. And the humanitarian work was pushed onto the neighboring countries of Ukraine, like Poland and Romania and the rest of them, then the European Union, then NATO, and then the United States. So we were like the fourth ring for humanitarian. So my posture and my job was to make sure that we had everything was operational. We had a lot of units, a lot of troops, a lot of weaponry in the region, and that's constantly taking, you know, you need to refuel, you need to rearm, you need to make sure things, casualty reps, we call them, like if something breaks down, are constantly being monitored and fixed. So I was the battle watch captain for my section, and I was on call 24/7, and I managed a team of about 50 officers and a few enlisted Marine and Navy assets. And so that was my job pretty much. I was on a working groups to help, execute the presidential drawdown orders from President Biden. Presidential drawdown orders were the exchange of weapons that we had in our inventory to Ukraine. So I was the representative from my fleet to the European command to make sure that we got those supplies and weapons to the Ukraine so we can actually keep them as a country.
And there's been a lot of discussion about the global influx of supplies, aid to Ukraine. What's your assessment of the situation? Is that going smoothly?
I think it's going well. It's very difficult to give supplies, including weapons, to a country in the middle of a war because the enemy, in this case Russia, knows that the weaponry are coming from the West, and they know the different supply routes for the most part. And at the same time, you also have humanitarian aid coming in, sometimes at the same supply route. So it became very challenging. But I will tell you, bar none, the United States has done the most out of any of the countries. We appreciate everybody's support, the NATO alliance, as well as some of the outside NATO alliance that came in and supported Ukraine with arms. But I fundamentally believe that Ukraine is here today because they were able to get the support, the military support, in order to survive. Those weapons, like the infamous Javelin and the Stinger missiles, one's used to shoot tanks and armor, one's used to shoot down rotary and fixed-wing aircraft, has really helped turn the tide of the war. So I am proud of the American mission there.
Were you able to interact, or did you interact with any Ukrainian soldiers or Ukrainian civilians?
We really did not. We kind of dealt with ourselves, the United States. Everybody had their tasking of who was doing what. You know, the president and the Joint Chiefs of Staff announced that we were giving artillery and certain other weaponry to the Ukrainians, and our job was to get that together and move it down the pipeline, and then we had liaisons that were able to do the handoff. So we personally did not interact with it. We basically just packaged up the goods and moved it down the pipeline where it was turned over at a border crossing.
So given what you experienced, what you saw, what's your assessment of the overall war in Ukraine and the future of it, the future for that region?
I think the future is very positive. I mean, obviously everybody's on pins and needles now. We still have a conflict going on, but you know, when I went over there, I was briefed and told that Ukraine is going to collapse within days. Our mission then was to secure the border and beef up Poland and neighboring countries and make sure we deal with the humanitarian crisis that was coming over the border at the time. They gave Ukraine the life expectancy of a goldfish. But thankfully, to the fighting spirit led by President Zelensky, that changed. And you know, I say this to a lot of people, if you look at the difference in other conflicts that we've been involved in, including Afghanistan, when the going got tough, a lot of these leaders took the American money, put it in a suitcase, and got the hell out. And that spirit of fleeing spreads to the population and the country collapsed. What happened here is you saw a leader like Zelensky galvanize and say, we're not going to take this. And that changed the spirit. So them holding the line and coupled with Western supplies of anti-armor and anti-aircraft weaponry allowed them to push the Russians back from the capital, which was really under siege, and really spread that around. So what does that mean for the future? Every one of those countries on the border, the Balkan states, Poland, Romania, are welcoming U.S. and Western troops and equipment, including anti-missile batteries like the Patriot systems. That will reinforce their lines and convince the Russians not to go further again. And I think one last thing I'll say to you is what this conflict has proved is, and this is what we say in the military overseas, is that the Russians aren't 10 feet tall and some super power thing. They took a licking from a very weakened force compared to theirs. And I don't think they have the capabilities of pushing into these other countries at this time. They're going to have to do a rearming of themselves and a re-strategizing. So I think the countries that are galvanized now, that are intact, including those border countries, are going to be protected going forward. And you know, we had a speech before we left here. We had a retired admiral talk about. He was an admiral during the 90s. He talked about in the 80s, the French had a huge army. You know, you're talking about these Western European and NATO countries had huge standing armies. The last 30 years, there's no reason to have one. So these countries really need to – you're going to see a major military buildup in Western Europe to answer this potential to make sure the Russians never think about going west.
We're speaking with Orange County Executive Stephen Neuhaus, who just returned to the U.S. after being deployed since mid-March with the Navy in Europe. How do you manage to stay up to date and lead the county while also being involved overseas?
I think a great question. What it's actually been proven, not only in my deployments in the past, but more during the COVID age, that you can get away with and get along and move forward by technology. And that has allowed me to basically be dual-hatted at times. And, you know, we had scheduled conversations every day. I was about a six-hour time difference in Europe, and I think it was seven in Iraq. So I'd be in my pajamas sometimes doing staff meetings or even doing addresses to, like, the Chamber of Commerce. I remember I got up at 2 o'clock in the morning for the New York State Association of Towns and Villages to their conference and spoke at 2 in the morning with my pajamas on to them. So you make it work. Technology is definitely key, and it becomes complicated sometimes if you don't have it, and you always have redundancy. I remember I did my State of the County address live from Baghdad. We did a pre-recorded version of it, which I hate doing, but we did it just in case I lost communications over there. So you always have that double integrity to make sure that you don't have any problems. But texting also is easy. There's also WhatsApp and Signal are immensely popular for the military over there. They take a lot less bandwidth. So all those coupled with very supportive commanders, you know, the active duty admirals and generals are like fascinated by the private sector because they're career military officers. And when they have this great diverse group of reservists and National Guard called in there, they're pretty supportive. And they're like, what? You do this and you're going to do that and we're going to do it live from here. So as long as you're not giving any secrets or anything that's going to reveal some positions, they're pretty cool with it. So I'm very lucky to have some great supportive leaders in the past, too.
That's Orange County Executive Stephen Neuhaus speaking with the Legislative Gazette's Jim Lavoulis. And that about does it for this week's show. We had help from the New York State Public Radio Network. For copies, call 1-800-323-9262. That's 1-800-323-9262. Ask for program number 2219. Or just listen at wamc.org or schedule a podcast wherever you get your podcasts. And join us again next week at this same time for more news on New York State government and politics. For the Legislative Gazette, I'm David Giustina.